Let us pray. Blessed Lord, you have caused all holy scriptures to be written for our learning. Grant that we may so learn them, read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest your word, that by patience and comfort of your holy word, we may embrace and ever hold fast to the blessed hope of everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. I want to thank Bjorn, thank the Norwegian Lutheran Missions, and thank you all for inviting me to come to America to preach the gospel to you. It is an honor. Norway. This is an honor. This is an honor. And I pray that I serve you well, because that's what I'm here to do. I'm here to serve. And so today, my apologies, this first lecture might feel like drinking from a fire hose. There's a lot of ground that we need to cover. We're going to be talking about sola scriptura, and I hope that in my excitement I don't get too fast for my translator. Eirik, where are you? Over there in the back. Okay, so if I see you doing this, I know. Okay. All right. Let me begin with a scenario. This is not reality. This is hypothetical. And the scenario is this. ISIS is proposing a plan for peace. You want us to stop killing you? Okay. What was that? Nothing? Okay. You want us to stop killing you? Well, we have a plan. Here's the plan. We want NATO, that would include the Norwegian military and the US military. Australia, New Zealand, well, they all must lay down their arms, destroy all their weapons, including all missiles, bombs, artillery, and firearms. Get rid of those things, and then we will have peace with you. Anyone think this is a good plan? Why not? Why do you think this is not a good plan? These are sincere people. They are religious people. They worship God. This is the religion of peace. No? No, you don't think this is a good idea, right? Well, I want you to consider this, and consider this idea, that we, all of us here, men and women, we are all soldiers. And Scripture reveals this. We are all soldiers of Christ. And being a soldier of Christ, it's a pretty important thing. But not just any soldiers. We were all born under the dominion of the archenemy of God. And we are only the latest generation, the latest and current generation, not even greatest, but latest generation of those whom God has raised up and given life to and set free from the devil. And so we are the latest generation of those who are armed combatants in a war that has been waging for millennia. And we do not know how long this war will continue to go on. It is a war between God and the devil. And the devil, his idea of peace is for us to lay down our weapons as Christians. And the only weapon we have is the Word of God. That's the context for which we're going to talk. Keep this in mind. When a military lays down its weapons, it's not because they've been victorious. It's because they are surrendering. And so my question for you is, have you been listening to the tactics of the devil? Have you been led to believe that peace with the world and peace with the devil is achievable by laying down the weapon that you have been commanded by God to wield? And that is the Word of God. I want you to think about this, and we'll talk about the devil's tactics as we go. A couple of passages to kind of bear this out, though. Philippians chapter 2, verse 25 says, I've thought it necessary to send to you Epaphroditus, my brother and fellow worker, and fellow soldier. 2 Timothy 2, 3 through 4. Share in suffering as a good soldier of Christ Jesus. No soldier gets entangled in civilian pursuits, since his aim is to please the one who enlisted him. And who is it that has enlisted you to be a soldier? Christ himself, the King. Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through 17. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. Now, I don't know about the Norwegian military. I don't know anything about it. But I would assume the Norwegian military is a lot like the United States military. When the United States, somebody joins the United States military, they go to boot camp. And in boot camp, they break you down. And soldiers don't have a will of their own. They are to do what they are told to do. They're given orders, right? Is it the same here in Norway?
Yes.
Yes. Soldiers, they stand at attention. And when their commanders say, do this, they do that, right? Now, I want you to consider this. God is speaking through the Apostle Paul here. Christ himself is speaking to you. And he is saying that you are a combatant. You are a soldier. And God wills for you to stand against the schemes of the devil, to put on the armor of God. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, and we don't. There is not a single human being alive, not one, from an ISIS terrorist to a pagan to an atheist who hates Christ, who is your enemy. Not one human being. You can pray for everyone. You can serve everyone, even a terrorist. The one person you cannot serve is the devil. This being is evil. We don't wrestle against flesh and blood. We wrestle against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, so that you may be able to withstand in the evil day. And having done all, to stand firm, stand therefore, having fastened on the belt of truth, that's right, no lie is of God. When the devil lies, he speaks his native language. We are not to mix the devil's lies with the truth. Having fastened on the belt of truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness as shoes for your feet, having put on the readiness given by the gospel of peace, in all circumstances, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish the flaming darts of the evil one. And take the helmet of salvation, and here it is, the one and only weapon. You ready? The sword of the Spirit. And this is the word of God. A Christian who doesn't know his Bible is an unarmed soldier. Unarmed soldiers are worthless on the battlefield. Absolutely worthless. The only thing they're good for is getting shot. That's it. Think that. Keep thinking that. Now to get to the topic proper. Sola Scriptura, the scripture alone. And I mean this. We live in a day where we are mixing all kinds of things with scripture. I think I know what that is. Yeah, I think it's my phone. I'm going to have to ditch this thing. Hang on a second here. I'm going to put this over here. We'll see if that solves the problem, right? Sola Scriptura is a controversial topic. And the reason why is because across the different denominations, pretty much all of the visible church rejects the idea, either formally or informally. But it's time for Christ's church to pay attention to something. If we're soldiers, then we are to take our orders from Christ. And these are Christ's words from the Great Commission. Jesus came and said to them, his disciples, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Who has it been given to? Christ. Not some, not partial authority, all of it. And he says, therefore, here are your marching orders, you soldiers. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Now watch this next part. Teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. All right. So, as a Christian, as a pastor, I have been given orders. I have been given orders to make disciples, to baptize, to teach. What am I to teach? Am I to teach what I like? What I think is reasonable? What the world wants to hear? Am I to mix my ideas with Jesus' ideas? The only thing I have authority to teach in Jesus' church, it's not mine, it's his. It's not yours, it's his. The only thing we are permitted by our King to preach and to teach are the things that he has commanded us. So where do you go to find what Jesus has commanded us? Who is Jesus? Well, he's none other than God in human flesh. So where can I go today to find the words of this God that I can say, these words are God's words. These words are Jesus' words. Where can I go? Can I climb a mountain and meditate and hear on the wind the voices of the Trinity speaking? No. Can I look deep inside of myself and feel things? Maybe I can be like a Jedi, right? Stretch out with my feelings, and then I can wield the sword of the Spirit without thinking, right? No. There's only one place I can go and know with any certainty that I have Christ's words, and that's the written word of God. I have no authority. You have no authority to speak any other words, to teach any other doctrines. To do that, well, that's insubordination. That's lawlessness. That's sin. There's people who are burning in hell for doing these things. For real. Thinking that they know better than God. They have changed his word into something else. They have preached from pulpits words that were not given them to speak. I can only speak what I am given. I'm just a creature. I've never had coffee with God. Never. Not once. I invite him up. I call him on my phone. I say, would you like to go to coffee? And he never says yes. It's weird, right? So I'll have to rely on the word. And so that's kind of the idea behind sola scriptura. Jesus says this in John chapter 14, verses 23 through 24. Jesus answered him, if anyone loves me, he will keep. Tereo, it means to guard, to hold sacred, to cherish. He will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with him. It's not me now. Yeah. Okay. If anyone loves me, he will keep my word. My Father will love him. We will come to him and make our home with him. Whoever does not love me does not keep my words. The person who despises Jesus' words, who despises the scriptures, despises Christ. And it doesn't matter if they say, well, I'm a Christian. It doesn't matter. There is a lady in Canada. She is a female pastor, which God's word forbids. But she's also an atheist. She was recently on a television program in Canada, and they interviewed her because she is a Christian pastor who is also an atheist. But this is silly. If I said I'm an atheist, but I believe in God, would you believe I was an atheist? No. Why not? Because words have meanings, right? The person who says that they are a Christian, who despises Jesus' word, who will not listen to the voice of Scripture, That's not a Christian. That's something else. Plain and simple. Don't sit here and tell me how much you love Jesus if you have a female pastor. You don't. Because Jesus, in his word, speaks to us and says that only men can be pastors. Don't tell me that you love Jesus and you love God, but you believe that men and men should be married. You don't love Jesus. You hate him. Let's be real. Right? Jesus says, whoever does not love me does not keep, does not guard my words. And the words you hear, it's not mine, but the Father's who sent me. These are Jesus' words. This is not my opinion I'm giving you. This is what he has said. A little bit of Latin. I don't know much Latin, but let's keep this in mind. This is an important phrase. This comes out of the time of the Reformation. Quod non est biblicum, non est theologicum. That which is not in the Bible is not theology. Let me say that again. That which is not in the Bible is not theology. Period. I don't care how popular the theologian is. I don't care how avant-garde he is considered to be. I mean, he's hip. He's cool. He's got something new to say to us. Well, if he has something new to say to us, then I don't need to listen to him at all. Because Scripture says that we believe the faith once delivered to the saints. Everything we believe, it's really old. Yeah. Very old. Really, 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 really old. Isn't that wonderful? Yes? All right. So let's talk about, before we get a little bit more into this, why does the devil attack the Word of God? Why? Have you ever stopped to think about this? Why does the devil attack the Word of God? There's some very basic reasons taught in the Scripture as to why the devil does such things. We're going to take a look at John chapter 20. We're going to take a look at Romans chapter 10, and I'll even throw in a little bit of Greek if you want to kind of put your fingers in your Bible, right? Let's see here. We'll do it this way. All right. Hold on a second. John chapter 20, verses 20 through 31. Here's what it says. And you can think of verse 31 as the thesis sentence of all of Scripture, not just the Gospel of John. And here's what John says. Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book. But these things are written so that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you might have life in his name. That's not just the Gospel of John. That's the whole Scripture. All of Scripture is about Jesus. It really is. Jesus said to the Jews, you diligently search the Scriptures because you think that in them you might have eternal life. But it is they that testify about me, and yet you refuse to come to me so that you might have life. This is what Jesus says. And so here Jesus says these things. John says these things are written so that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and by believing you might have life in his name. Do you know that it is the Word of God that creates the church? Did you know that? Who of you can say that you are a Christian today because an eagle sung a song to you? Or you felt a whisper in your heart? Every one of you is a Christian today because you heard the gospel. You heard the news that Christ has bled and died for your sins. And you know what God did? Through the preaching of his word, the written word, you were raised from the dead and given new life in Christ. The word of God is living and active. It's not a dead word. And I'm talking about the written word. And the devil knows this. The devil wants to silence God because his word does things. Let's take a look at that next passage. Our next passage is Romans 10. Romans 10, 11 through 17. And while you're getting that out, yep, good. All right. Listen to this. Verse 11. The scripture says, everyone who believes in him will not be put to shame. Everyone. Everyone who believes in Jesus. Everyone who trusts that he has bled and died for their sins. They will be saved. Doesn't matter if you are the lowliest of the low, the sinner of the sinners. Christ forgives. He's bled and died for your sins. Everyone who believes in him will not be put to shame. There is no distinction between Jew and Greek, between Norwegian and U.S., right? For the same Lord is Lord of all, bestowing his riches on all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. And you know what everyone means there? Everyone. Even a sinner like me and a sinner like you. And then Paul asks this question. How then will they call on him whom they have not believed? Well, they can't. How are they to believe in him of whom they have never heard? They can't. And how are they to hear without someone preaching? They can't. This is why we send missionaries, is it not? Because there's people living in the world who have never heard of Jesus. We've got to get to them. We've got to preach the gospel to them. Because they will not believe and be saved if they do not hear this message. And how are they to preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the good news. But they have not all obeyed the gospel. For Isaiah says, Lord, who has believed what he has heard from us? And then verse 17 says something that I think this translation, and pretty much every translation, has a difficult time capturing what's going on in the Greek, and I'll try to explain it. Faith comes from hearing, and hearing through the word of Christ. Now, your translation may say hearing through the word of God. It may say that. The oldest manuscripts say Christ, not God, but that's a different thing altogether. Faith comes from hearing, hearing through the word of Christ. Let me show you the Greek on this from a slide that I've prepared. Ara heis pistis, ex akaes, hede akae, di rematas Christu. Now, here's the important part. Let me see if I can get this to hide something really quick here. I want to hide presenter notes. There we go. Ah, that's a little big. Almost there, almost there. Good, here we go. So I have something to point with, okay? If you know Greek, you're going to notice something here. Hara he pistas ek akais. There's no verb. Therefore, the faith, you can say is, the faith is from hearing. And it's not a faith, it's the faith. The faith is from hearing. It comes from hearing. And this is not a one-time thing. The faith is from hearing. And the hearing through the word of Christ. That's hearing now, hearing again, and hearing again. It's like with little children, when they have a favorite book that they like you to read to them. You read the book, and what does the little child say? Again? Again? Can I hear it again? Yeah? I need to hear the gospel again. You need to hear the gospel again. Faith, it's from hearing. The faith is from hearing. And the hearing is through the word of Christ. Not the word of Immanuel Kant. Not the word of Hegel. Not the word of Plato and Aristotle. The word of Christ. The philosophers have nothing to offer us by way of salvation. Nothing. So we come back. Let's review. Let's go back to the scene of the crime. There was a crime that took place many thousands of years ago. Not millions, but thousands. It took place in a garden. Where? On earth? I don't know exactly. The world has changed since the flood. But we know this. The serpent was more crafty than any other beast of the field that the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman that God had made, did God really say? Do you notice what the devil is doing? What is the devil attacking? The first move by the devil, he attacks the very word of God. Now, in America, we talk about a one-trick pony, okay? A one-trick pony is a very impressive pony, but it can only do one thing, okay? If you teach it to jump through a hoop, that's the only thing it could do. It'll jump through a hoop. One trick, okay? The devil is a lot like a one-trick pony. If he were a chess player, he'd have the same opening every single time. Plays the same pieces. Always attacks the same way. What's the thing he attacks? The word of God. Always. Because he knows that God's word is living, active. That whatever God's word, God sends it out to do, it accomplishes it. God cannot say, let there be light, and darkness remains. It's not me. It's not me, right? So the devil says, did God really say, you shall not eat of any tree in the garden? Is that what God said? Do you remember? No, that's not what he said. Did God say that you really shall not eat of any tree in the garden? And the woman said to the serpent, well, we may eat of the fruit of the trees in the garden, but God said, you shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that's in the midst of the garden, neither shall you touch it, lest you die. Yikes. Or bad Norwegian, ufta, right? Yeah? That's not what God said. Okay. Now watch this next part. But the serpent said to the woman, and you can almost hear him say it, syrupy, drippy lies. Oh, you will not surely die. I'm your friend. I love you. God doesn't. I'm going to tell you the truth. God's not telling you the truth. You can almost hear him talking like this, right? For God knows when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened. You'll be like God, knowing good and evil, right? Run away. Watch this. So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, what's she doing? She's not looking now at God's word anymore. She's looking inside of herself. Well, it is good looking for food. It's a delight to the eyes. She's looking inside now. She's no longer hearing the voice of God. And that the tree was to be, watch the word, desired. Desire. I desire. Is this not how sin operates? It begins with that desire inside of you, right? I want that thing. I want that person. I want that person dead. I want. I desire, right? Already sin is at work in her. If the snake had bit her, we'd say the venom was already starting to take effect. And a desire, it was a delight to the eyes, desired to me make one wise. She took its fruit, ate, and she also gave some to her husband, who happened to be not three blocks away, but was right there with her. Right? And he ate. And the eyes of both were opened. And they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves loincloths. So there it is. The greatest attack in our race that has plunged all of this into this darkness has forced every single one of us to be born dead in trespasses and sins. You think we're so smart spiritually? When Jesus himself, our creator, shows up on earth, nobody would have known it if angels hadn't told us it was happening. That's how blind we are. Sad state of affairs, right? And just like the devil, We all say things to ourselves that are akin to, did God really say? Do we not? Should I be looking at that site on the internet? Well, did God really say? Should I be dating that person who's a total pagan? Well, did God really say? Should I be attending that church with the female pastrix? Did God really say? Right? Do I really need to believe that Jesus is the only way of salvation? Did God really say? We do this in a thousand myriad different ways, and there's a reason for this. Because when the devil did his work, you'll notice Eve goes internal rather than looking external to the Word of God. The devil made her into what's called an enthusiast. Enthusiasm. It means God within-ism. And that's our problem. We're all born enthusiasts. That's the problem. A little bit of a quote here from the Small Called Articles from the Book of Concord. Let me read what Luther wrote. In these matters which concern the external spoken word, we must hold firmly to the conviction that God gives no one his spirit or grace except through or with the external word which comes before. Thus, we shall be protected from the enthusiasts. That is, from the spiritualists who boast that they possess the spirit without and before the word, and who therefore judge, interpret, and twist the scriptures or the spoken word according to their pleasure. Thomas Munzer. Have you all heard of Thomas Munzer? No? All right. Thomas Munzer was a guy during the time of the Reformation, the time of Martin Luther, who, he was one of these guys who was like a charismatic. And he told Luther pretty much that you follow the dead word, I follow the spirit, right? And Luther said to Munzer, Munzer, I wouldn't believe you if you had swallowed the Holy Spirit, feathers and all. Yeah? Luther was right. Yeah? So Munzer did this, and many still do it in our day, who wish to distinguish sharply between the letter and the spirit without knowing what they say or teach. How many times have you talked to somebody who said, listen, we don't follow that dead word, we follow the spirit. And by dead word, what do they mean? The Bible. That's silly. All scripture is God-breathed. There is no difference, if you really want to get technical, between the work of the Spirit and the work of the written word, because all of the written word was inspired, breathed out from God. You can go, God is speaking. This is the only place I can go. Luther continues. He says the papacy, too, yeah, that's right, is nothing but enthusiasm. For the Pope boasts all laws are in the shrine of his heart, and he claims that whatever he decides and commands in his churches is spirit and law, when it is above and contrary to the scriptures or the spoken word. All of this is the old devil, the old serpent, who made enthusiasts out of Adam and Eve. He led them from the external word of God to spiritualizing and to their own imaginations. And he did this through other external words. Even so, the enthusiasts of our day condemn the external word. Yet they do not remain silent. Instead, they fill the whole world with their chattering and their scribbling, as if the Spirit could not come through the scriptures or the spoken word of the apostles. Instead, it must come through their own writings and their words. And that's the trick, isn't it? That's the trick. The devil has made us all into enthusiasts, and what he wants us to do is believe we can attack the word of God, and as soon as you attack the word of God, well, you've got to fill the vacuum with something. So now God doesn't come through the Bible. God comes through, well, what I think, what I believe, right? And you know what we all do? We all do this when we sit in our small group Bible studies and you read a passage, and then they ask that all-important question, what does this mean to you? Oh. Ah. Well, this verse means fairies and ponies and unicorns and hugging trees and eating granola. Oh, that's good. Very good. I affirm you. You think I'm making that up? Try this one. Read a text like, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son that whoever believes in him will not perish but have eternal life. And then say what this passage says is that there's salvation only in Jesus. And they'll go, oh, closed-minded, bigot, hater. Yeah? Will they not? How dare you? They talk about love and tolerance, but the thing they will not tolerate is the truth. And all the while, they have you reading the Bible, but never to understand what God says in it. Instead, they have you reading the Bible, well, in order to use it as the playground for your imagination, to stretch out your inner enthusiast, give it room to run. All the while, you're heading to hell, not towards the heavenly kingdom. Think about that. Luther was right. Luther said this also. In a word, enthusiasm inheres in Adam, his children, from the beginning, from the first fall, to the end of the world. Its poison having been implanted and infused in them by the old dragon, and it is the original power, life, and strength of all heresy. Where does heresy come from? Man's vain imaginations. That's where it all comes from. And there isn't a heresy on this planet that can save you. Not one. Not a single one. So let's talk about enthusiasms. There's several. Let's work this out. First, man-made doctrines and traditions. There's one particular branch of the visible church that is well excelling in this. We'll talk about another one, though. Human reason and philosophy. That's a form of enthusiasm, looking inside. And then the so-called direct revelation or subjective experiences. These are also forms of enthusiasm. Enthusiasm takes on many forms. Well, these are the three top ones that we'll cover today. So let's take a look at this. Man-made doctrines and tradition. Open up your Bible to Mark chapter 7. Do a little mini teaching along the way. I told you, drinking from a fire hose, right? Mark chapter 7, verse 1. Now when the Pharisees gathered to him, that's Jesus, with some of the scribes who had come from Jerusalem, they saw that some of the disciples ate with hands that were defiled, that is, they were unwashed. For the Pharisees and all the Jews do not eat unless they wash their hands properly, holding to the tradition of the elders. And when they come from the marketplace, they do not eat unless they wash. And there are many other traditions that they observe, such as the washing of cups and pots, copper vessels, and dining couches. And the Pharisees and the scribes asked Jesus, "Why do your disciples not walk according to the tradition of the elders, but they eat with defiled hands?" Now we'll pause there for a second. Okay, I want you to notice this. Jesus is performing miracles. We're in chapter 7. He's fed 5,000. He's healed a woman with an issue of blood that she had for 12 years, raised Jairus' daughter from the grave. He's walked on water. He's cast out demons. He's healed the sick. He's given the ability to walk to one who was paralyzed, right? And so what happens? The Pharisees, they send a delegation, and the delegation is from headquarters. We've heard about this Jesus, and we need to see if Jesus is on the level. Does he get our stamp of approval, right? And so they spend the whole day with Jesus, and now it's time for dinner. And what happens? They go into someone's home, and in the Jewish homes at that time, there was a little vessel that held water and a water pitcher. It wasn't very big. And you were supposed to stop by and wash your hands in this little religious ceremony, which I'll describe in a second. And you know what the disciples did? They skipped the wash basin because Jesus taught them to. They skipped that little wash basin and they went right to the dinner table. And you can almost hear Peter say, Hey, John, could you pass over the lutefisk, right? No, they didn't say that. Okay. Yeah. Maybe it was lefse. Okay. No. Right? And what happens to the Pharisees? The Pharisees do this. This is not good. And this is where they decide to go to war. Jesus has now crossed a line. And it's a very important line. And you got to know the reason for this. Now, if you are familiar with the writings of the Pharisees, you can find this in the Jerusalem Talmud, the Babylonian Talmud, and the Mishnah. All right? But at the time of Jesus, they didn't write this stuff down. They hadn't written it down yet. And what the Pharisees taught, and you'll notice something here, when you read the Old Testament, look hard for Pharisees in the Old Testament. You won't find them. They're not there. When the Old Testament canon closes with the prophet Malachi, no mention of Pharisees. They come up during the intertestamental period. They are usurpers. They are the ones in John chapter 10 that Jesus said were the hirelings who jumped the fence. They had no commission from God to do the things that they were doing. And yet they came up and they had this, well, mythology that they created. And the mythology was this. They said that when Moses went up on Mount Sinai, he not only received the written Torah, he also received the oral Torah. Two books. One written, one oral. This is what they claimed. And the rule to wash your hands, it's not in the written Torah, although my mom wants it to be, okay? It's not. The rule to wash your hands is in the oral Torah. And the name of the oral Torah at the time of Jesus was the tradition of the elders. That's a formal title. So if you look in your Bible, okay, when it says that they didn't, for the Pharisees and the Jews do not eat unless they wash their hands properly, holding to the tradition of the elders, that should be capitalized. It's a formal title, all right? And in the tradition of the elders, the oral Torah, here's how the commandment goes. When you are out among the unbelievers, the pagans, the Gentiles, you become unclean by being in their presence. And so before you eat, you come into your home, you go to the pitcher, and here's how you do this. It's very explicit. You take the pitcher with your right hand, you put your left hand over the basin, palm down, pour a little water on it. Switch hands, right hand, palm down, pour a little water on it. Switch hands again, open up your left hand, pour water on the inside of your left hand, switch again, right hand, pour water on it, and then you say this. I thank you, Lord God, creator of heaven and earth, that you have given me the command to wash my hands. The end. That's all you had to do. And the disciples did not do this. And there's a very specific reason why they did not do this. Because Jesus told them not to. And because Jesus told them not to, Jesus said and was saying, and the Pharisees got this, that whole oral Torah, which is where the Pharisees got their authority from, by the way, that it was all garbage. It had no authority. It wasn't to be recognized. It wasn't to be obeyed. And so let's go back to our story. Watch this. So here's the question again, verse 5. Why do your disciples not walk according to, and this should be capitalized, the tradition of the elders, but they eat with defiled hands? Jesus doesn't say, oh, boys, sorry, guys, we didn't mean to offend you. Get back over here and wash your hands. No, he doesn't say that. Well did Isaiah prophesy of you, you hypocrites. This people honors me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching as doctrines the commandments of men. Quod non est biblicum, non est theologicum. If it's not in the Bible, it's not theology. And Jesus, with this one statement, has made it perfectly clear. Every doctrine of man is to be stricken down mercilessly in his church. It is not to be listened to. It is not to be obeyed. We are not to bend the knee to other men. Christ is king. To obey the commands of men in his church is to obey the devil. He showed them no mercy, only law. And he goes on. You leave the commandment of God and you hold to the tradition of men. Oh, no, 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 that's not true, Jesus. We believe in the written Torah, but we also believe in the tradition of the elders. We don't not believe in the Torah. Jesus says you can't believe both. It's one or the other. You're either going to listen to God or you're going to listen to man. Plain and simple. You have a fine way. Watch this. You have a fine way of rejecting the commandment of God in order to establish your tradition. Whose? Theirs. Not God's. But you know what the Pharisees did? They established all of their traditions in the name of the Lord. They prayed to God. They worshiped God. You remember the Pharisee? In the parable of the Pharisee and the tax collector, he was at the temple. I thank you, Lord, that I am not like other men. See, they pray to God. This is all delusion. It's demonic self-delusion. This is enthusiasm. You think you can lay your doctrines next to God's? Jesus says when you do this, you reject God's word. You establish your own tradition. And here he gives examples. For Moses said, fourth commandment, sorry for those of you Calvinists, fourth commandment, honor your father and your mother. Whoever reviles father and mother must surely die the death. That's what the scripture says, the commandment says. But watch what he says. But you say. But you say. If a man tells his father or his mother, hey, mom, dad, whatever you would have gained from me, well, that's Corban. I'm now going to give that as a gift to God. Then you no longer permit him to do anything for his father or mother. That was their tradition, their commandment. And their commandment made God's commandment void. How do you think that's going to go for them on the day of judgment, by the way? You think it'll go well? Oh, that's okay. Bygones be bygones. It's all right. I understand. I mean, after all, all that matters is that you love some kind of God, right? Or as the Japanese say, oh, there's many trails that lead to the top of Mount Fuji. Well, I grant you, all roads do lead to the judgment seat of God. Not all roads after that lead to eternal life. Only one does. So whatever you would have gained from me, well, that's korban. That's a gift given to God. And you no longer permit anything for them to do anything for father and mother. Thus, making void the word of God by your tradition that you have handed down. Many such things you do. Man-made commandments make God's word void. Not because God's word can be voided, but what you end up doing is voiding it for yourself. I know better than the Holy Spirit, therefore I have commanded. That's demonic pride. That's exalting yourself, your ideas, your reasons, your thoughts, which you think the way things should be. above what God has revealed they are. You're living in a delusion. You're living in a lie. Let me come back to our slides. Human philosophy and reason. These often are other forms of enthusiasm. Let's take a look at Colossians 2, 6 through 8. Give me a second. It came over with a bullet. There we go. Therefore, as you received Christ Jesus the Lord, and so walk in him, rooted and built up in him, and established in the faith, just as you were taught, abounding in thanksgiving. See to it that no one takes you captive by philosophy and empty deceit, according to human tradition, according to the elemental spirits of the world, and not according to Christ. Let me tell you something about philosophers. I've studied philosophy as an adult for a very long time. And the one thing I've learned about philosophers, they have a game that they play. It's like a generational game of King of the Hill. Do you play that here in Norway? Somebody gets to the top of the hill, right? And then it's somebody else's job to knock them off the top of the hill. So Plato was at the top of the hill. Aristotle knocked him off, right? And then a successive generation of philosophers. You think of the scholastics, you think of the moderns, and now the postmoderns are at the top of the hill. But you know what's happening down at the bottom of the hill of philosophy? At the bottom of the hill, this next generation is saying they don't want to believe in postmodernism, and so they're concocting their new philosophy, and they're getting ready to launch an all-out blitzkrieg, an assault on the postmoderns who are at the top of the philosophy mountain right now. And when they do, nobody will want to be postmodern anymore. Everybody will want to be what the new philosophy is, right? Now, just by its very nature then, is philosophy a safe place to ground what you believe the truth is in? No. And God, speaking through his word, says that philosophy, it's empty deceit, and it's according to human tradition, and according to the elemental spirits of this world, and not according to Christ. So if Foucault and Derrida and all of the postmoderns sit there and say that words mean nothing, and everyone goes, now we've got to change Christianity so we can be postmodern, take the person, slap them in the face, and say, wake up. God warned us. This is enthusiasm. We're not to let the philosophers tell us how to understand Scripture. Instead, we're to tell the philosophers, that's stupid. That's worldly. That's nonsense. Last year you believed this. This year you believed that. Which is it? You don't believe in truth at all, do you? You just like playing little games with words, thinking that you're so smart and making everyone think, oh, you're so smart. It's nonsense. It's all going to burn. What's the one thing that endures forever? The word of the Lord. The word of the Lord endures forever. Long after people are done talking about Foucault and Derrida and Rorty, you know who people will be talking about? Jesus Christ. Because Foucault and Derrida, they're going to stand before Christ. Christ does not stand before them. And you are unwise and foolish to make Jesus bend the knee to the latest generation of philosophers. That's enthusiasm. And it's sinful to the core. Let's go back to our thing. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. Verses 20 through 25. The Apostle Paul writes, where's the one who is wise? Where's the scribe? Where's the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, It pleased God through the folly of what we preach to save those who believe. Somebody's sending a very long text message. We'll wait for a second. I don't know. It's definitely cell phone interference, you can tell. All right, let's go back. It's the devil. Yeah. So watch what Paul says, talking about the wise. And he says this, that it pleased God through the folly of what we preach to save those who believe. You do understand, you believe, well, at least you should, that your salvation was accomplished by a Jew who hung on a cross, who bled and died for your sins. You do know that, right? Boy, that's serious. Yeah. Oh, wait another second here. It's not settling down. And it's okay. I'm here all night. Yeah. Well, I'm on North Dakota time, so you know, it's early there. I mean, so yeah. It's 2 in the afternoon, so we have time. Yeah? All right. Yes, okay. We will pray for you. Lord, give him strength. Okay. All right. I think we're back. So notice here, the scripture says that what we preach is folly. And watch this. For the Jews demand signs, the Greeks seek wisdom. But watch this. We preach Christ crucified. And you know what it is? The world, when they hear the story of the cross, they're not going to sit there and go, this is the best thing we've ever heard. The world says, ah, what? This is a stumbling block to Jews. And it's complete folly. It's foolishness to Gentiles. But you know what happens? We Christians, we don't like it when our friends say, why do you believe something like that? You believe what? Are you mentally ill? What's wrong with you? Right? And we sit there and go, yeah, what is wrong with me? I have an idea. Let's change the message altogether. Christianity is no longer about the crucified guy on the cross bleeding and dying for our sins. I know. It's about going and making the world a better place. Remember to recycle. Right? We're going to go conquer poverty in the name of Jesus, and that's the good news. No, that is not the good news. Okay? And so the thing we should expect when we preach the cross is that people scoff at this. We preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews, folly to Gentiles. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. And because the world thinks this is foolishness, because people think this is folly, we must anticipate that's what they're going to say, and we must say, yes, I know you think this is foolishness, but you need to repent. You need to be forgiven. You're heading to hell. You might think this is silly that I'm telling you a joke. This is no joke. And if they unfriend you on Facebook, that's not real persecution, by the way. I just want to make that clear. I've been unfriended thousands of times. Okay. And I've been blocked, too. Okay. People don't ever want to see me again. Okay. This is what we are to expect. All right. And see, what happens is that we oftentimes work from a very bad assumption. Look at our churches. They're not very big. They don't have a lot of people there, right? And we think that somehow this is odd. But is it? What's the reason why unbelievers are not in our churches on Sunday? It's because they hate God. Nobody is Switzerland when it comes to Jesus. Switzerland, they're neutral, right? You fight, we stay out of it, right? Nobody is Switzerland when it comes to Jesus. You are either a penitent believer who's bent the knee and say, Jesus, you are my Lord and my God. Or you are a belligerent doing the work of the devil and you hate Jesus. End of story. Why do we let people who hate Jesus tell us how to do church? That doesn't make any sense. That's like letting the crazy people run the asylum. That would not be a very safe asylum, right? Another text, Luke chapter 1. I want to give you another example of reason here. Sometimes reason takes a very fascinating form, where it gets into the driver's seat and it denies that God can do things. Let me explain, okay? Have you ever run across the person who says, oh yes, I'm a Christian, but I don't believe in miracles. I'm a Christian, but I don't believe that Jesus really rose from the dead. I'm a Christian, but I don't believe the flood. I'm a Christian, but not God creating the world in 6 days, bah. Right? Why is that? You know why? Because they've exalted their reason above the word of God. It's just plain and simple. We'll talk about this a little bit. Let me give you an example from scriptures of where this happened. And this is, we read this during the Christmas season, okay? Starting at verse 5, chapter 1 of Luke. In the days of Herod, the king of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah of the division of Abijah. He had a wife from the daughters of Aaron. Her name was Elizabeth. And they were both righteous before God, walking blamelessly in all the commandments and statutes of the Lord, but they had no children. And Elizabeth was barren, and both were really old. Okay? Elizabeth and Zechariah, these are your grandma and grandpa. No. Great-grandma, great-grandpa, right? They're really old. Great-grandma having a baby? Whoa. Okay? That just doesn't happen. Now watch what happens. Now while he was serving as priest before God when his division was on duty, according to the custom of the priesthood, he was chosen by lot to enter the temple of the Lord and to burn incense. And the whole multitude of the people were praying outside at the hour of incense. Oh, that reminds you of that song. Let your prayers rise before you as incense, the lifting up of my hands as the evening sacrifice. This is what this is referring to. And there appeared to him an angel of the Lord standing on the right side of the altar of incense. Zechariah was troubled when he saw him, and fear fell upon him. But the angel said to him, "Do not fear, Zechariah. Your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you shall call his name John." Now, when do you think the last time Zechariah prayed to God that his wife would have a child? Yesterday? 30 years ago? Maybe. Yes, yeah, but not yesterday, you know? So that prayer, I prayed that a long time ago. Now watch. You will have joy and gladness. Many will rejoice at his birth, for he will be great before the Lord, and he must not drink wine or strong drink. He will be filled with the Holy Spirit, even from his mother's womb. And he will turn many of the children of Israel to the Lord their God. He will go before him in the spirit and the power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, to make ready for the Lord a people prepared. Now, question. This is the angel Gabriel. Where did Gabriel get these words? Who gave Gabriel these words? God. God, right. So was Gabriel speaking his thoughts, his ideas, his opinions? Was he engaging in philosophy? No. He was delivering a message. That's all he was doing. And he spoke the word faithfully that God told him to speak and to whom he was to speak it. And watch this. Zechariah said to the angel, "How shall I know this? For I'm an old man. My wife is advanced in years." And again, everyone said, "Oofta." Right? This is a mess. What's Zechariah doing? He's thinking with his mind, and his reason is above the word of God delivered to him by an angel. And how silly is this? He's troubled because there's an angel standing there in the Holy of Holies. Right? He's freaked out. The angel has to say, "Don't fear. I've got a message for you from God." And he delivers the message and he goes, "Yeah, right? Did God not speak the universe into existence in 6 days? Did he not? Of course he did. Do you think God's going to have a hard time opening the womb of great Oma? No, not at all. God is God. And here's what the angel says. "I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God. I was sent to speak to you and to bring you this good news. And behold, you're going to be silent, unable to speak until the day that these things take place, because you did not believe my words, which will be fulfilled in their time." Oh, if only God would strike with silence every unbelieving pastor. Right? Now, I want you to think for a second. You laugh. I want to show you another passage. This is off topic, but on topic. Titus chapter 1. Paul writing to Titus, verse 5. "This is why I left you in Crete, so that you might put what remained into order, appoint elders in every town as I directed you. If anyone is above reproach, husband of one wife, his children are believers, not open to the charge of debauchery or insubordination. For an overseer as God's steward must be above reproach, must not be arrogant or quick-tempered or a drunkard or violent or greedy for gain. Instead, he has to be hospitable, a lover of good, self-controlled, upright, holy, disciplined. He must hold firm to the trustworthy word as taught, so that he may be able to give instruction in sound." And by the way, that word sound means healthy. Healthy doctrine. Think of false doctrine as a pestilence disease. Oozy, pussy, gross, disgusting, blah, vomit. That's what false doctrine is, right? "He may be able to give instruction in healthy doctrine." And watch this. "To rebuke those who contradict it." Rebuke them. Now, I understand, here in Norway, you don't like conflict, but you are all soldiers. Your king says you must engage in conflict. When there is false doctrine, somebody's teaching it, you must stand up, and you must say, "No, that is not the truth. You are lying." And watch why. "For there are many who are insubordinate, and they are empty talkers. They are deceivers, especially those of the circumcision party." And watch this. "They must be," what? "Silenced." Zechariah was silenced because he did not believe the word of the Lord. And now God commands that you silence those who do not believe the word of the Lord. Not an angel. You, believers, they must be silenced. God wills for false teachers to be silenced. We haven't done that. We've sinned. We're all guilty of this, and we need to repent. But let me first assure you of this, that every time you have feared and you have not spoken up, that was a sin. But it's also a sin that Christ has bled and died for. Repent and be forgiven for this sin. You are not to be the silenced. The devil wants you silent. The false teachers, they must be silenced. This is what Christ wills. So repent, be forgiven for your silence, and then bear fruit in keeping with repentance by always speaking up, never tolerating when a false teacher speaks falsely and deceives people. This is what Christ wills for us to do, right? Let me come back. How are we doing on time? Oh, yes. I'm going to set the record. All right. Let me read a little bit more. Francis Pieper, Lutheran dogmatician, writes, "Making natural reason the judge of matters religious is metabasis es allogenas." That means a transgression to another genus. Okay? It's a technical term. In other words, it's to attempt to set up human unreason as the teacher in the Christian church in place of the Word of God. That's what that means. And see, that's the thing. We all suffer from this. All of us who are regenerate, we still have our old sinful nature, and it wars against the new nature, and it wars against the Spirit, and it wars against the Word of God, right? When we sin against God, we sin against God in thought, word, deed, by what we do, by what we don't do. We sin against God in many different ways, actively, passively, all forms of ways. But oftentimes when we think about sin, what we think about when it comes to sin is, well, you know, the sins of the flesh. I don't steal. I don't sleep with my girlfriend. I don't lie about my neighbor, things like this. These are good things that you are not doing, right? Right? But there's two tables to God's law. The first table is our relationship to God. You shall have no other gods before me, is the first commandment. When was the last time you thought that your erring doctrine, your ideas that are conflicting with God's word, that's idolatry? And it is. You're exalting your unreason above God's word. You cannot do this. You cannot do this. You must repent. Then you ask the question, but what about evolution? What about the flood? What about Jonah and the big fish? What about, right? Well, let me introduce you to the greatest living expert on the scriptures and what they mean. Okay? I want you to think about this, okay? Professor Schultz over at Tübingen, right? He's got 3 PhDs. Professor Schultz says, I have 3 PhDs, and the flood never happened. I've got 3 PhDs. I'm a doctor of theology, and I don't believe that Jonah was really in the belly of a great fish for 3 days. No, 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 no. That's all myth. You believe me, I have three PhDs, right? Well, those are impressive PhDs, are they not? 3 of them. Wow. I'm impressed. Not really. Okay. All right. I'd like to introduce you to the greatest living expert on the scriptures and their meaning. Who is that? Oh, his name is Jesus Christ. Have you heard of him? Do you know that Jesus is the only living human eyewitness to the creation of the world? He's the only living eyewitness. He was there. In fact, he's the one who said, "Let there be light." He was there. When the flood occurred on the earth, who was it that told the deep and the springs and the wells of the deep to let loose the torrent of their waters? Who was it? Oh, it was Jesus. He's God in human flesh. Let me tell you about his credentials. One time Jesus went into the temple and he made a cord of whips. A whip out of cords, and he drove the money changers out of the temple. And the Jews were very upset. They were making a lot of money. Jesus was bad for business, okay? So they said, "By what authority are you doing these things?" And here's what Jesus said: "Tear down this temple, and I will build it again in 3 days." And they said, "Pah, it's taken 46 years to build this temple, and you're going to build it again in 3 days? Are you out of your mind?" And then the text says this. The temple he was referring to was the temple of his body. You see, the sign that Jesus gave that he had the authority to do what he did, he gave that sign. Because on the third day, after they had him crucified, the grave was empty. Jesus walked out of the tomb. He's alive. Now, unless Professor Schultz can give me greater credentials than that, I'm going to go with Jesus as far as how I should understand the creation, the flood, and Jonah, and everything else. Do you know of anybody who's died and risen from the grave after 3 days? Any theology professors that can do better than Jesus? No? All right. Let's listen to what Jesus said. Matthew 19. The Pharisees came up to Jesus, and they tested him by asking, "Is it lawful to divorce one's wife for any cause?" Oh, those rascally Pharisees. They're always trying to trick Jesus, right? So Jesus answered, "Have you not read that he who created them from the beginning made them male and female, and said, 'Therefore a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So they're no longer two, but one flesh. What therefore God has joined together, let not man separate.'" Does it sound to you like Jesus believes in a literal Adam and Eve? Of course he does. Who do you think formed Adam from the dust of the earth? It was Jesus. He who created them from the beginning made them male and female. Oh, this is where marriage is established too. Notice it's Adam and Eve, not Adam and Steve. Right? This is what the text says. Next, how about the flood? Matthew 24, 36 through 39. "Concerning that day and hour," talking about Jesus' return in glory to judge the living and the dead, "not even the angels of heaven, nor the Son, but the Father only. For as were the days of Noah, so will be the coming of the Son of Man. For as in those days before the flood, they were eating, and they were drinking, marrying, and giving in marriage, until the day when Noah entered the ark, and they were unaware until the flood came and swept them all away. So will be the coming of the Son of Man." Does that sound like Jesus actually believed that whole ark thing was real? Of course he was. Of course he did. Who do you think shut the door of the ark? Jesus did. He was there. Right? How about that whole Jonah in the fish thing? Matthew 12. Jesus answered them, "An evil and adulterous generation seeks for a sign. No sign will be given to it, except for the sign of the prophet Jonah. For just as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the great fish, so will be the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. The men of Nineveh will rise up at the judgment with this generation. They will condemn it. For they repented at the preaching of Jonah, and behold, someone greater than Jonah is here." Does it sound like Jesus actually believed that whole fish story was true? Of course. Who do you think Jonah prayed to? Right? So unless you can get me better credentials than Jesus' credentials, I don't care what your opinion is. Your opinion can burn in hell with you. You want to deny these miracles of the Bible and rewrite them to fit your reason? You've made your reason into an idol, and you need to repent. You do not know better than Jesus. He is the Lord of the universe. And to have an opinion of these things different than Jesus, well, that's just sinful foolishness. Who do you think you are? Who's going to stand before whom at the judgment? Is Jesus going to stand before you? How dare you, Jesus, flood the world with a flood? How dare you create the world in 6 days? That's unreasonable. I've got a good line of atheistic scholars and scientists who all say that we evolved from an ape. How dare you say that you created us? Is not that what the person is doing? They're exalting themselves over the word of God. And they are standing in judgment over God. But that's what our sin does. And we've learned it from the devil. Right? Next one. Direct revelation and subjective experience. This is a subtle one. This is a subtle one. Turn with me to Jeremiah 23. Somebody gets up at TBN and they say, God has shown me this. I was taken away in the spirit. I've been to the heavenly of heavenlies. I went into the wine cellar of God and I drank heavily. I wish I was making that up. I really do. Right? Should you believe that person? God has told me that his favorite color is pink. Should you believe me? Well, let's take a look at Scripture. Jeremiah 23. Thus says Yahweh. Yahweh, the Lord of hosts. Do not listen to the words of the prophets who prophesy to you, filling you with vain hopes. They speak visions of their own minds, not from the mouth of the Lord. They say continually to those who despise the word of the Lord, oh, it shall be well with you. And to everyone who stubbornly follows his own heart, they say, no disaster shall come upon you. So the television preacher gets up and he stands in front of the camera and he smiles. And you can see a little glint flashing off of his teeth. Right? And he says to you, you are the head and not the tail. Send me a seed offering. Show God that you have faith. And make the check large. The one who sows sparingly reaps sparingly. The one who sows abundantly reaps abundantly. You want a blessing from God. Well, God wants you to be healthy. God wants you to be wealthy. God has told me that I have the ability to release creative miracles to you. Make the check out to Kenneth Copeland, Joyce Meyer, Benny Hinn. Notice something. Has that person confronted you with your sin? Has that person placarded Christ and him crucified for the forgiveness of your sins? Or has he filled your mind with nonsense? Do you really think that if you send money to a televangelist, that God is going to bless you and make you a millionaire and make you cancer-free? No. Not at all. Right? Oh, but thus saith the Lord. Kenneth Copeland, on New Year's Eve this year, actually, New Year's Eve last year that went into this year, literally said, God told me that whatever your heart can dream for in the year 2016, God is going to give it to you. And I said, Napoleon Dynamite style, yes, I dream that you go away, that nobody listens to you. My heart is big with this faith, right? They say, thus saith the Lord. Who among them has stood in the counsel of the Lord to see and hear his word? Who has paid attention to his word and listened? Behold, the storm of Yahweh, wrath has gone forth, a whirling tempest. It will burst upon the head of the wicked. The anger of the Lord will not turn back until he has executed and accomplished the intents of his heart. In the later days, you will understand it clearly. I did not send the prophets, and yet they ran. I did not speak to them, yet they prophesied. But if they had stood in my counsel, then they would have proclaimed my words to my people. Notice that again. My words, my people. Whose words? God's. And this is invoking the one speaking here, right here. You see the words capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D. That's the divine name of God, Yahweh. The tetragrammaton for it is right here. That is God's personal name. I did not send the prophets, they ran. If they had stood in my counsel, they would have proclaimed my words. Am I a God at hand, declares the Lord, Yahweh, and not a God far away? Can a man hide himself in secret places so that I cannot see him? I don't think so, declares the Lord. Do I not fill heaven and earth, declares Yahweh? I have heard what the prophets say, who said, who prophesy lies in my name, saying, I have dreamed a dream. So what? I dream dreams all the time. They're kind of bizarre, a little bit weird. Right? And every time I think I can fly, I end up falling and waking up. There go my dreams of being Peter Pan. By the way, I'd look pretty bad in green spandex. But okay. All right. The Lord continues, how long shall there be lies in the heart of the prophets who prophesy lies, who prophesy the deceit of their own heart? And there it is. Where is this really coming from? Their own heart. They're enthusiasts, right? Who think to make my people forget my name by their dreams. They tell one another, even as their fathers forgot my name for Baal. So notice, all of these false prophets, God himself likens them to idolaters. The very ones who worship Baal. That's what these false prophets are. So let the prophet who has a dream, well, tell the dream. But let him who has my word speak my word faithfully. What is straw in common with wheat, declares the Lord? Nothing. Absolutely nothing. So let me ask you a question. Do you have the Lord's words? Yes or no? Do you have them or not? Where are they? Are they in here or are they in that book? They're in the book. I challenge you, and I don't normally challenge, but I challenge you, master this book if you can. Master it if you can. But I promise you, it is alive and active. And if you try to master it, it will master you. That is a good thing. It'll show you the deceit of your own heart. It'll show you the depth of your sin, which you need to know. Because Christ himself says, the one who is forgiven much loves much. Do you feel that your prayers fail? Do you feel that your heart is not completely with God? How many times do you think I am so weak? You look at your own Christian life and you say, I have no strength for these things. I'm too busy text messaging. Right? So what do you think the solution to this is? What is the solution? Try harder? I know. Baron Munchausen, I'll pull myself up by my bootstraps. Good luck on that. Laws of physics don't say that's possible. Look into the Word of God. Look into His holy law. Hold it up to your face and see the depth of your sin. You do not measure up. I do not measure up. There isn't a day that goes by in my life where I cannot and do not pray, forgive me my trespasses. And you know what? He does. He does. Oh, Lord, if you kept a record of wrongs, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness. Therefore you are feared. To love God is to first know your sin and know your forgiveness. Know the depth of your forgiveness and you will have true love for God. But this is only found in this book, nowhere else. There is nowhere you can go to find words from this God except for in this book. Nowhere. You can't look for him inside of here. He's not there. Not the way you think. You don't decide truth by saying, oh, that feels good, that feels right, I had a peace about it. No, open up the word. What does God's word say? What has he told me he wants me to believe, to teach, to confess, to do? Not every passage of scripture has an application like you would think. Okay? Think about this. The angel Gabriel appears to the Virgin Mary and says, behold, you're going to give birth to the Messiah. He's going to be the Savior of the world. His name will be Jesus, Yeshua, the Lord saves. And what does she say? Be it done to me as your word says. Sometimes the right application of the scripture is to say, I believe. You cannot be the virgin who gives birth. The virgin birth has nothing to do with you achieving some dream for your life. The virgin birth has to do with the good news that unto you is born a Savior. And that's what you need. And that's what I need. The devil hates God's word. Faith comes by hearing. Hearing by the word of Christ. And it keeps coming. I've got to get these people to stop speaking, to stop preaching, to shut up, to lay down their arms. I've got to disarm these soldiers so that they do not go and make disciples of all nations. He knows his time is short. You want to hasten the day? Preach the word. And when somebody spits in your face, you pray for them. They're not your enemy. Christ bled and died for them too. And when they tell you you're stupid for believing that Jesus created the world in 6 days, you pray for them and you tell them this, repent. Christ has bled and died even for that idolatrous sin of yours. Repent and be forgiven. You see, what's at stake is everything. These things are written so that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God. And that by believing, have life in his name. I promise you, every one of you, you are all dying. You're all dead men walking. I've seen death as a pastor. I've seen the fear on people's faces as they know they're getting ready to breathe their last breaths. And I know that in that moment, they are looking for comfort. And you will too someday. What will you find it in? Philosophy? False prophecies? Your own reason? Will you say, well, I was a good person. I paid my taxes. I never went to prison. So God will let me in. Is that what you'll say? There's no comfort in that. Or will you say, like the tax collector at the temple, at the time of the sacrifice of the lamb, Lord, be propitious to me. I am a sinner. I am a sinner. Remember the Pharisee, how he prayed? Oh, I thank you that I'm not like other men. Oh, I'm so good. I tithe all the way down to a tenth of my spices. Oh, what a good boy I am. But Jesus says of the tax collector, the one who said, Lord, have mercy on me, be propitious to me, pointing to the sacrifice, the 3 p.m. sacrifice of that lamb who's had its throat slit for the forgiveness of sins, pointing to Jesus, Lord, have mercy on me, I'm a sinner. Sola Scriptura is all about the gospel and about the only message that can save. And it's such good news, it can save you. It's true. Jesus Christ came to save sinners, and you qualify. you qualify. Right? Let's finish up. I've only got 900 more slides. I'll cut it down to 800. Regarding personal experience, I want you to pay attention to the Apostle Peter. 2 Peter chapter 1. For we did not follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. We were eyewitnesses of his majesty. I struggle with this because I want to see his face. I want to see Jesus. I want to see this man who bled for me. And I must confess, I'm jealous of Peter because he's seen him. And I haven't. But he writes so that I can believe, so that you can. For when he, Jesus, received honor and glory from God the Father, and the voice was borne to him by the majestic glory, "This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased." We ourselves, we heard this very voice born from heaven, and we were with him on the holy mountain. This is the time of the transfiguration. Jesus takes Peter, James, and John, and they go up to the top of the mountain. And just for a minute, his glory comes out. The one who emptied himself, even though he was by nature God, and was found in the form of a servant, born in a manger, not in a palace. For just a moment, he lets his glory out. And there's Moses and Elijah. And the text says that they were speaking of his exodus, talking about his journey to the cross. What a sight to behold. I know charismatics who'd sell their mothers into slavery to be able to see something like that, and I wish I was lying, but they would. And despite all of this, that amazing experience, we ourselves, we heard the very voice born from heaven. We were with him on the holy mountain. And we, now talking about us, we have the prophetic word more fully confirmed. You can translate this as even more certain, to which you would do well to pay attention as to a lamp shining in a dark place. Peter's not pointing us to his experience. He's now pointing us to the written word of God, and you would do well to pay attention to it. Until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts, knowing this first of all, no prophecy of Scripture comes from someone's own interpretation. No, for no prophecy was ever produced by the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. See, in many various ways, God spoke in the past to the prophets. But Hebrews tells us that now God has spoken to us by his Son. And the King of Kings has given us a charge. And let me remind you, make disciples. Make disciples. And you think, how can I do this, Lord? How can I do this? The cost is so great. My reputation will be smeared. People will hate me. They'll despise me. I won't be able to make a large sum of money for my retirement. The cost is great, Lord. But it's not you who makes disciples. It's God. But he makes them through you. God has chosen in his sovereignty that the message of the gospel is to go out not by the mouth of angels, but by the mouth of sinful men. You and me. We're all soldiers. Go make disciples of all nations, every one of them, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to observe all that I have commanded. Sola Scriptura is what Jesus has commanded his church. I will only preach words of God from God's word. Because these are the things that Christ has commanded me to teach, to preach. Philosophy, sketchy, dodgy prophecies, I've not been given to preach. And he says, lo, I'm with you always, even to the end of the age. God has chosen that from the time of Christ's ascension to the time of his return, only one doctrine is to be preached. The scripture is closed. We preach only Christ. We only preach his words, none other. This is what he's commanded us. And if you have preached or taught or believed anything other than this, then repent and know that Christ has bled and died for that idolatry, because that's what that is. Receive his forgiveness. Trust in his forgiveness and mercy. And then go and bear fruit in keeping with that repentance by sticking only to his word, and pay attention to the words, to the nouns, to the verbs, to the grammar. It all matters. Master this book, and I promise he will master you through it. In the name of Jesus, amen.